Welcome. I will call to order the April 25th City Council meeting. We have a full room. Welcome, everyone. And we have two items on the agenda, and we are going to start at general orders. And when we talk about one topic, we have some speakers signed up to speak. When we talk about tennis, and we'll have tennis speakers. When we talk about downtown redevelopment, same thing. First thing I'd like to do is ask everybody to join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. That takes us to general orders. Item A, presentation by Stillwater Tennis Association on proposed tennis court construction project. Mr. McNichol.
Henri Wahara will make that presentation.
Good afternoon, City Council. My name is Henri Wahara. I'm with the Stillwater Tennis Association and a graduate of the C.E. Donner High School and played on the tennis team many, many years ago on the same courts that we're going to be talking about today. First of all, I'd like to congratulate Chris Young and the OSU women's tennis team for winning the Big 12 championship. I'm sure that's the first of many more to come. I'd also like to thank all the tennis supporters, and particularly Coach Leslie Rourke for getting the troops out to support our study session this evening. Coach Rourke, you want to stand up and say hello? She's a pioneer tennis coach and also in charge of the junior high teams, and has done a lot with very few resources. So I congratulate all the work that they've been able to accomplish with the minimal resources they have. I want to thank the City Council for giving us the opportunity to talk about the tennis facility situation that we've been dealing with for the past several years. as you know, it's been a somewhat difficult road getting here today, and I'm hoping that we can come up with some solutions that will lead to better results in the future. I'd like to thank the city staff, Jim Scott and John McClenney, for working with us, and some of the STA members that contributed to the project that we've been working on for the past 2 years, particularly Jeannie Homer. I don't know if she's in the audience. Jeannie, she is the architect at OSU and helped in the design and the plan of the Hamilton Field project. Jeff Hadwiger, who's the vice president of STA, and Les Imboden. I don't know if they're in the audience. Jeff has a Monday league to run this evening, so he may not be here. So why are we here? We're here to deal with quite a few issues. Let me see if this thing clicks forward. Yep. The issues that we're here to discuss is one, we have some existing facilities that are in dire need of repair and renovation. They really need to be rebuilt in order for future use. We have in the city very limited court capacity, and in particular, the most number of courts we have in one location is four, whereas the type of tennis activities, as you can see from the turnout, requires us to really have a minimum of 6 to 8 in one location, so we're trying to figure out how to get to that point. And finally, we have a limited number of courts for a town of 50,000. We have basically 8 total courts spread across 2 sites, and some of the studies we've done in the past indicate many more are necessary for a city the size of Stillwater. So let's get to the overview. Most of us here are tennis players, but for those of you that aren't tennis players, it really is a low-cost, family-oriented, lifetime sport that brings high-impact health benefits to people that play tennis. And it also brings a positive, active community image that any progressive leading city like Stillwater would want to offer its residents. Thus far, Stillwater has 8 courts built over 40 years ago, located across 2 sites, Couch Park and Sunset. Both owned by the city of Stillwater, the public school system has none, which is very unusual. Stillwater has an active adult and senior tennis community. It numbers over 200, and we have a growing 10 and under juniors, junior high, and high school player, active players that increase this count to well over 300. If you include casual tennis players and maybe the college students from OSU, this number easily increases by hundreds. So in 2013, a bunch of us tennis players formed a committee called Save Our Courts and performed a survey back in 2013 of comparable cities in Oklahoma and the Big 12 that showed that the average number of courts appropriate for the size of Stillwater would number somewhere from 18 to 20. In fact, the Stillwater master plan that was put together a few years ago by the city staff indicated somewhere on the order of 22. Our tennis facilities are subpar relative to any comparable city in the state of Oklahoma or in the Big 12. As of 2013, no courts were in acceptable playing condition. And that began some actions by the city council to try to address these issues. But really, the message is, building a first-class tennis facility is one of the lower-cost capital expenditure quality-of-life projects that a town like Stillwater can undertake. And it really does deliver a big bang for the buck. First-class standalone tennis facility, based on the analysis after going through this process, can realistically be built for $700,000 to $900,000. So the big picture, as I said, 18 to 20 courts would be the appropriate number of courts available to the public. If you count the number of courts at OSU, Colvin Center, courts that number 8, they are not available to the general public, plus the 4 at Sunset and the 4 Couch Park. These are neighborhood courts. The finite resources of a community like Stillwater should concentrate its firepower on one central location while still maintaining neighborhood courts. The community really needs a facility with 6 to 8 lighted courts in one location to support the public school programs, junior development, adult tennis leagues, junior tennis leagues, tennis clinics, and tournaments. There are primarily 2 types of tournaments that really would need this type of facility, the tournaments that are run by the OSSAA and USTA-sanctioned tournaments, and of course, Chris Young might mention something about his need for some tennis courts in the future. Examples of single location court capacity, say at Ponca, a smaller town than us, 9, Enid, 8, Muskogee, 8, Perry, 6, much smaller community than us, Shawnee, 6, Henrietta, 6. Some of these courts are located at the high school, and the natural location for a facility like this would be at the high school. Ideal solution would involve a joint project between the city, the public school system, and why do I bring up SMC? Because if you look at some of the wellness centers around the state, many of those actually have tennis courts on next to fitness centers, pools, and recreational facilities. So I thought that maybe bringing in SMC into the picture might be of help. Cost of facility, again, can be done for $700,000 to $900,000, depending on the site location.
And that had how many courts?
That would be between 6 and 8. Actions taken to date by the City Council. We spent $38,000 back in 2013 to resurface the courts at Sunset, which were in terrible shape. Those are asphalt courts that had very large cracks, not safe to play on, and we had to do a short-term fix with understanding that problems would reappear. They've already reappeared. They're starting to fall apart again. $400,000 was approved in the fiscal year 2014 budget to renovate the existing Couch Park courts, the four courts, in calendar year 2015. Here's what happened after that. The STA and the city staff got together to see whether, rather than just do the renovation, whether it might be something better we could do with the funds that were approved. And so we worked on a plan that would address both the short-term and long-term issues that face the city with regards to tennis facilities. And we came up with a plan to build new courts at Hamilton Field, specifically to save cost, yet allow for future expansion. We spent entire 2015 coming up with the plan and the design. We assumed the cost would be no more than $100,000 per court, which is basically the range that most tennis builders and the USTA bring up when they say how much would a tennis facility cost. On the low side, it can be as low as $75,000. We went out to bid earlier this year in February. We only received three bids, and they were all over $1 million. And that was way out of our budget, so all the bids were rejected. I spent quite a bit of time looking into why we received such high bids. I talked with every subcontractor, every contractor, general contractor, the geotechnical analysis firm, the architects, engineers that worked on this project, other tennis courts builders, including one that Chris Young had recommended that we talk to. What I found out was we received uncompetitive court construction and light fixture bids that were anywhere from $100,000 to $200,000 over what they should have been or what they could be. Site prep and earthwork costs due to soil conditions to stabilize the soil ran anywhere from $50,000 to $100,000 over what could have been expected. And we did add some design features, and we maybe overspec some things that cost somewhere around $50,000 over what could have been done. So when you add all that up together, even with design adjustments and cost reductions, a facility at Hamilton Field would exceed $800,000 to do. That would be for the six courts. So the status right now is that we're on hold awaiting the results of our study session tonight and direction from the City Council. What are the possible future actions that we can take? Obviously, we can renovate the existing Couch Park courts using the remaining budgeted funds. We can renovate the existing Sunset Park courts and add lighting. Something has to be done about the Sunset Park courts. We can always expand Couch Park courts to address the single location capacity issue. The one that I will bring up several times tonight is that we can build a new 6-to-8 court facility, not at Couch Park, to address both the single location issue and court capacity issue that faces the city. I'd like to revisit, in that case, all potential sites, including property that the city owns, the public school, and possibly the SMC. Another possibility would be to consider selling Sunset Park if we're not going to maintain it properly, and use the proceeds toward a new facility that would not be located at Couch. The reason for that would be if you used the proceeds to continue building at Couch, all the tennis facilities in town would be in one location. I know that the path of least resistance is going to be to expand at Couch Park, because it's going to be the simplest, quickest, and dirtiest solution, but what I want to raise is whatever we decide or whatever the City Council decides, we're going to live with for the next 40 years, like we've done with Couch Park up to now. So why did we decide to build at Hamilton Field in the first place? Couch Park is really a compromise. The original recommendation of the Save Our Courts Committee back in 2013 was that we should locate at the high school on the Cimarron Plaza site, but we were told, and obviously it's only a year from now. We were told that it would be unavailable until at least 2017. So the time frames didn't match, and we were forced to look at other sites to consider. And so we looked at places like Southern Woods and Boomer Lake. And we concluded that Couch Park was the best, most cost-effective site to build on because of its existing infrastructure and the flat grade on Hamilton Field, which we thought would be very suitable for tennis courts. We did expect the plan would come in close to the cost of rebuilding existing courts, at most $100,000 per court. I did cross my fingers and think we might be able to get down to $75,000, but that was obviously unrealistic. With bids coming in well over $1 million, the original motivation for building a new facility at Couch no longer applies. Here are the things that I hear from other players, and there's a feeling Couch Park is an isolated, low-profile site outside the mainstream of city life. It really is sort of nestled in the periphery of city activity. It is an inconvenient location for the public school tennis programs to commute from the high school and from the middle school and from the junior high locations over to Couch. Obviously, the baseball team and all that probably have the same argument to make. It is more difficult to attract players to go out there and to increase the usage of those courts. And whatever we decide, we'll have to live with that decision for the next 40 years. So, finally, short term, what's our recommendation? Retire the Hamilton Field plan that we came up with because it was done specifically to reduce costs, but the result was the exact opposite. It really isn't a cost-effective solution. Use the remaining fiscal year 2014 budgeted funds to quickly renovate, meaning post-tension concrete overlay over the existing Couch Park courts, and replace the fencing this year. The result would be tennis courts that really do look brand new and would last another 40 years, possibly. And I'd like to see us form a multi-institutional committee to come up with a long-term solution comprised of the city staff, the public school system, SMC, and STA representatives, with the goal of, in the long term, building a new 6-to-8 court facility in a more central location, preferably at the high school, in a joint development with all these institutions. I do have some closing comments that are somewhat unrelated, but related to the tennis facility thing, but more in general. I've been working with the city council for several years now and looking at how things are done. And I wanted to make a few comments on what I thought might be done to help in tackling these type of capital expenditure projects. I know I've gone, when I was doing the original study back in 2013, and I went and looked at a lot of municipal budgets from other communities, one thing that I noticed is that ones that were well run had what's called a five-year capital improvement master plan that they tended to follow. They tried to identify the type of projects that they felt should be done in the community and then prioritize them. And then they allocated a certain percentage of their annual budget to these type of quality of life or capital improvements projects. And I'd like to see the city do something like that, and hopefully a tennis facility would be part of that list. For a city the size of Stillwater, it really does, with the limited resources that each institution has, it really does make sense to pool resources among the different institutions, the city, the public schools, Stillwater Medical Center, to achieve a common capital expenditure objective like the tennis facility. I know that the SMC actually contributed funds to build the splash pad, which I think is great. They've been able to come up with funds to do a warm water pool facility and a fitness center, which is great. I know that there was talk many years ago at the Cimarron Plaza of doing a natatorium or a wellness, a community center, a wellness center that would take the place of the YMCA as well as some of the functions that the SMC is doing now at that new facility. But that type of cooperative project, I really think a city like Stillwater needs to pursue. Another thing that I haven't seen is a process where a capital expenditure project that can't be handled in 1 year, there's no mechanism, it seems like, to be able to fund a project like that. And it would be nice if you could come up with some kind of a mechanism or process where not following the current annual ad hoc approach, but make something like a layaway plan, like you would going to Walmart for Christmas, and there's a really nice toy that you want to buy, but you can't afford it right away. So you start putting in some funds on a regular basis to be able to afford to get it for Christmas. And so somewhat analogous to that, it would be nice to have a mechanism to do this for at the city that spans multiple years to be able to afford a larger project like maybe a tennis facility. And finally, for this master plan, I mean, obviously the way to fund most large-scale capital improvement projects, infrastructure, would be to go out to the debt markets. And I looked at the financials of the city, and I talked to your CFO here, and the amount of indebtedness that the city has is actually not very bad at all. It's, you guys are very frugal. And I think, you know, we have historic low interest rates right now. And so it sure would be nice if once you come up with a plan of the type of capital projects that you'd like to tackle, that I bet you the residents of the city would be very much supportive of going out to the debt markets to be able to fund those type of projects. Anyway, I think that's all my comments. I have some background material, maybe because some of these people haven't seen what the Hamilton Field plan was. This was the project at Hamilton Field that Jeannie Homer and the design architects down in Oklahoma City came up with. It was a six-court facility with a social terrace in the middle. The bottom structure is a Hamilton Field house. There were viewing berms on either side of the, on the top side, on either side of the middle two courts. And we had backboards, we had 10 and under lines, junior lines. So all in all, it was a pretty intimate, very attractive layout for being able to hold tennis events. In any case, well, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Do you want to ask questions now?
I don't care, whatever. I've got a couple questions, but I can hear the speakers. Whatever you want to do.
Okay, let's have the speakers come up as well, and then we can start asking questions. Would that be okay? J.D. Carlson.
Well, thank you. I'm here to support the idea of improving our tennis courts, and as you can see here, tennis is a sport for the young, but it's also a sport for the old like me. And I'm speaking on behalf of adult tennis players, and in particular the Stillwater Tennis Association. One of the criteria, and as I approach retirement age, I know I don't look that old, but if I were to move out of the city of Stillwater to some other state, one of the strong criteria I would have would be to choose a city or town that has good tennis courts, because I plan to keep playing into my 80s and 90s. Maybe not singles, but doubles at least. So even from the idea of attracting new people to Stillwater, you know, older people that may come here to retire or adults coming in, it's good to have good tennis courts, because it's a sport you can play well until you're very old. So I just wanted to ask you to do what you can do to support tennis in Stillwater and improve our facilities, and with the money that you have, and hopefully we can get some more as the economy improves. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carlson. Leslie Roark. Did I say it right? Roark? Well, okay.
Depends on where you live. Roark or Roark is fine, yes. I'm the head coach for the high school girls and boys and the junior high girls and boys. Just to give you a little background, a couple years ago, well, 38 years ago, I was on the only state championship team that we've had. And so we did have a history of having very strong tennis. And then it's kind of waxed and waned over the years, and we're working towards a much more stable, growing sport. And I have to tip my hat to Chris Young here. He has brought to Stillwater such an awareness of tennis for our youth. You know, we go to his matches, we go watch those girls, and the kids are, they're inspired to take on the sport. And the USTA has also changed their formats on how they approach 10 and under tennis. So I foresee it really expanding in our school system. We had 23 kids on our roster last year for 7th grade through 12th. We have 46 this year. So we are growing, expanding with a lot of excitement with the kids. And I have to also thank our school board and how they support us, because we don't have the facilities to host a lot of events. So they are paying for us to go to events all around the state in order to have our kids play and compete. And that's, you know, the reverse of what we'd like to mix it up to have a lot of people come to Stillwater. It's also good for our economy to have our tournaments here and have more people experience Stillwater. So I would also just ask you to kind of look at it in terms of the future of our kids being able to play. We have our practices. Chris has wonderful camps and clinics and instruction, but we need a place for them to practice. And it's like taking a piano lesson and not having a piano to practice at home. You just don't improve as much. But if you have a facility that is very welcoming and is very available, those kids are going to practice and they're going to play and they're going to enjoy it and grow much faster than if it's very limited on when they can get out and do that. So that's just kind of all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. And our last speaker for tennis is Chris Young.
I really didn't know what I was getting myself into coming here. But I spoke with Norm recently, and I know Gina, we've exchanged some messages. I don't know how much you guys are aware, but we had the nicest tennis facility in the country, collegiate tennis facility at Oklahoma State. And if you would have said that 7 or 8 years ago, people would have laughed at you, probably still do. But I'm a visionary for, I think, what can happen in this community in Oklahoma State. I grew up in Oklahoma as a tennis player like all these kids did. And when looking at coming to Oklahoma State, I did it because I wanted to help tennis in this state. I wanted to help youth tennis. I wanted to help people to see that tennis in this country can happen here in Oklahoma. Yesterday, I was watching tennis on ESPN3. They were hosting conference championship, and it was discussed that the best three tennis facilities in the country could possibly collegiately in Oklahoma, at Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Oklahoma State. I think that's remarkable that at Stillwater we have something that can be one of the nicest in the country, and that's a tennis facility. I'm trying to bring tennis events to our facility all the time. We've hosted two regional championships, which have had over 100 hotel nights, estimated between $800,000 and $1 million to our economy the last 2 years. We're hosting the Big 12 tournament this year, and we have people staying as far away as Edmond. Fans obviously couldn't get because of all the other events that are happening this weekend as well, hotels, so people are going to be staying all over, and we want to do a good job of hosting that. Part of our challenge is, where do the teams practice? We're hosting matches on all 12 courts, so where do the teams practice? We are putting in a bid in June to host the national championships. The NCAA national championships go out to bid in June, will be decided on in September for 2019, 2020, and 2021. Tulsa is getting to host this national championship coming up in May. They're estimating a $5 million economic impact to the city of Tulsa for that event. That's remarkable, and that can happen here in Stillwater. We're already recognized as one of the best facilities, if not the best, to host the event. My challenge is, one of the requirements for this event is 18 off-site practice courts. And as Henri has mentioned to you, that's our challenge. We have everything that needs to happen, but how do we get the 18 practice courts? Well, we can raise the money and resurface the Colvin courts, which gives us 8. We can use the 4 at Sunset that gets us to 12. but where do we come up with the other six? That's the challenge. And so that's where I've gotten really involved, not only because most of these kids take lessons from our staff and we have a special place in our heart for these kids, but also what can we do for the city? And I would hate for this round of bids to go out for the NCAA and us not be able to bid because we don't have enough courts, because I think, honestly, I can't see a reason why we wouldn't get one of these next 3-year bids if we just have practice courts to show for it. And so we were really racking our heads at school, like, what are we going to do? And then we heard, well, you know, there's at least a plan out there for 6 courts. And so we wanted to jump behind and support it. And I'm happy to support it any way possible. I know we have a great architect, Jim Hassenbank, here in the audience who helped us design the facility. I took our court construction guy that helped with our courts with Henri to look at the facility. I think there's things that can be done. I really do. I think some of the numbers that have been thrown around, in my opinion, are high. I think there's things that can be done to build new construction courts for less than what's being discussed. I think it's just getting the right plans in place. Obviously, the soil and all that, I understand. But you know, Henrietta just built a brand new 6-court facility. There's other places around the state. I just talked to the USTA on my way in and talked to them about this meeting. And there is grant money available that I can for sure bring to the table. And I know that if we can tie that in with hosting the NCAA championships, I think there's a partnership that can happen. I'm also going to be announcing pretty soon, most likely, that we're going to be bringing a women's professional tournament to Stillwater in September. I think there are some things that are going to happen here in tennis that have never been done before. And I think it's an exciting time. I hope that we can all get on board together and join forces. And I think the future is behind me, not only with these kids, but I think it's a great opportunity for us to do something for our city. Just from an economic standpoint, I think I can assure you that from my side, we can bring first-class events to Stillwater. There's not many sports that you can bring national championship events in Stillwater. Golf and tennis are the two. That's it. And that's why we spent over $18 million into a facility to do it. And I sure wouldn't want to come up short because we're short on practice courts in the community. Thank you.
Mr. McNichol?
Well, a couple of things that I would like to respond to. One, Henri, if you'll take a look at the city website, you will find at least a five, and I think a 10-year capital plan there. In addition, we took a look at next year's capital budget for the general fund, and we're actually spending 9.71% of that capital expenditure for quality of life issues. In this case, it's 3 parks. The other thing that I would tell you that is, Henri was correct, we have enough money, and thanks to Chris, Coach Young, we have enough money to resurface those courts at Hamilton Field, or at Couch Park, whichever way you want to look at it. One of the issues that staff recognizes is that at another location, you're talking about, in addition to the center, you've got to build parking, you've got to acquire the land. Depending on where you put it, you may still have to deal with expansive soils. I get the it's not in the mainstream argument. We happen to own it. The expansive soil issue, I think, it could be encountered anywhere in Stillwater. And in visiting with several people about soccer, there's a representative here, I don't want to speak for them, but Stillwater Public Schools, as everyone aware, is currently cutting a sizable amount of money from their budget. And my understanding is that the Cimarron Plaza property will probably remain as is until that debt is retired and or they find perhaps benefactors to start the project that they have long-term goal for. So it may be a lot longer than 2017. Finally, in terms of going into debt for projects, that's certainly something that staff has kicked around. We need to relocate a fire station at the cost of about $5.5 million, and we need desperately need a new animal welfare building at about the same cost. We have had recreational issues on general obligation bond elections at least three times that I know of, two in the recent past, and they were all soundly defeated. We are simply looking for council direction in this area. We can, again, put post-tension concrete slabs over the existing courts at Couch Park, and I think come up with a pretty nice facility that should last for quite a period of time. It would have to be resurfaced on occasion. In relation to Sunset Park, we have looked at that. There are, if you drive by that and look at it, there the park's kind of in a bowl, and a lot of water drains there, and there is water surfacing through cracks in the tennis court. If we were to rebuild those or do the same thing that we think we need to do, or the staff would recommend that we do at the current Couch Park facility, there would have to be some drainage issues addressed at that location. And as Henri says, there's no lights, and some of that's in a residential area. I don't know what kind of issues that might cause with nearby residents. But specifically, the direction that staff was looking for tonight was to let bids for reconstructing the facilities in Couch Park, and we think we have sufficient funds in the budget to do that with the post-tension concrete and the surface area, and that would at least get four into reasonably playable condition. And then if we can pursue the grants that Coach Young talked about, that would be greatly helpful.
Yeah, I have some questions about those grants. Counselors, questions?
Comments? No question about the willingness and the desire to do anything at all that we can foster activity, group sport, anything that people enjoy doing. Would love to have just a bottomless pocketbook for all these great things. It's been amazing to me over the time that I've been on City Council to recognize that, you know, you have a great turnout for the tennis, you have a great turnout for the skateboard, you have a great turnout for the singers at the community center, you have a great turnout for the park, whatever. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are so many interesting things to do, and although this is a packed room, we get packed rooms for many, many different interests, so it's really a balancing act, and it would be very nice to be able to say we can do everything. I love the emphasis on partnership. Absolutely has been a mantra. None of us in Stillwater are large enough to do everything. We have got to figure out how we can do things together. Public schools, YMCA, medical center, OSU, would love to be able to see that be in all of our activities, something that we just take for granted. I like the idea of getting the courts resurfaced so you can see something quickly and move on. It does not mean that in the future we can't have a single location someplace else or other types of plans, but I think that the need is there for good courts for all of these folks. I would really like to see a public-private cooperation is similar to our multi-arts or Lake McMurtry. Mm-hmm. And within that, I would love to see leadership, membership of all of the big players in Stillwater.
Agreed. Councilor Nahara.
I'm just curious, where you said moving the parks or moving the courts, where would you recommend? Do you have an idea rather than Couch Park? Will you come up to the mic, please?
Our recommendation is that it naturally belongs and it should belong at the high school.
Okay.
But I know that there are issues there. I'd like to explore those issues with the public school system, actually, in conjunction with the city. I don't know if we've seriously talked to them about it yet. I mean, we've had sort of on and off discussions, but it would be nice if we really tackled this and put it to bed once and for all. If we can't build there, we can't build there, but then why do we have that property? I don't understand. But in any case, you know, even the baseball team and all that, they probably want to see something done there at that facility as well, because they're playing out at Couch Park. If it wasn't possible to build at the high school, there are other sites that to be considered. One would be Southern Woods. That's a city property. We looked at Boomer Lake. We ruled that out initially because the infrastructure on the east side wasn't developed. We didn't ever consider anything on the west side, where there are bathroom facilities, and there used to be two existing tennis courts there. But what I'm saying is, if we're going to spend this much money to build a 6-to-8 court facility, I'd like to try to, first of all, come up with a thorough investigation of all the options available, including even with SMC. I don't know. Maybe it's a long shot, but maybe they have some property somewhere that they could where they would be willing to let us build on their property. But one thing that I'd like to do is try to locate this facility in an area that does encourage participation and is more centrally located. But Southern Woods, Boomer Lake, I mean, even Strickland Park used to be where a bunch of tennis courts used to exist there, and now they've been, they're underneath the parking lot. But I know that there's not a lot of space there, or there's the baseball fields that are being used by SASA, but a centrally located facility would be desirable for us.
So with the, and the slide's not up there anymore, so I just want to remember, with the $370,000 we have allocated right now, your recommendation would be to just go ahead and redo Couch, but then you'd,
yes,
in the future,
yes,
if we can work with USDA and
exactly
and find a miracle.
We need to quickly, we spent, you know, I'll take responsibility for it too. I mean, if we were on top of our game, we probably could have called this maybe a year ago or 6 months ago, a little bit earlier. So I'll take responsibility for this situation. We need to now, because of the delay in getting the Couch Park Court situation fixed, we need a solution right away. And so the best thing to do, and based on my discussions with the tennis court subcontractors, they can do this post-tension concrete overlay over the existing courts and make those rock solid, as good as building brand new for the funds that have already been budgeted. So that's something that we could do very quickly.
Would that take the entire fund?
Most of it, yeah. There might be some left over. A little bit, but not much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Do we have money budgeted for maintenance on these courts so that we don't end up with courts that haven't been maintained in another few years like the ones we have now?
Chris can probably talk about it, but it's typically $1,000 a year per court for maintenance that you only do once every 4 or 5 years. So every 4 or 5 years, we're talking $4,000 or $5,000 per court.
Yeah, I mean, that's not in the city's budget,
no,
right? I mean, that's not.
No. If that's what you're asking.
Okay. No.
Any idea on the grants, how much we could get? Yeah, if you don't.
So the grants right now that are available that I've talked to USTA about is a $50,000 grant for $500,000 project. is basically 10% that they would kick in. There are some additional funds that they would do for resurfacing. If we would put the 10 and under lines, there's a 10 and under court that's smaller now than their regular court. And so if you come in and you resurface those and you put those lines on there, which is a no-brainer for us to do because it would help our 10 and under program, but it also bring events, 10 and under tournaments here, then you could get grants that could help with some of the resurfacing issues. As Henri talked about, I mean, resurfacing a tennis court, it's about $3,000 to $5,000 a court, and you need to do that every 4 to 5 years, as much play as these are going to get. So I don't have the answers to, you know, where the money comes from. I agree completely with the public-private partnership. You know, I'm from the city of Norman. When I grew up, there was four courts. If you look at the Westwood Tennis Center now, I think Norman's a great model for us to follow. They have 12 courts. The city has continued to expand with a public-private partnership, and now they're hosting national USTA events. And I never thought growing up that I would ever see that when I was hitting on four courts with a backboard, very similar to what we have here in Stillwater. But I think the biggest thing with getting new courts is you're going to have the opportunity to host events here. All these kids are traveling every week to tournaments, and we should be having some of those here. And I think that's where some of the money to maintenance would come in.
Have we had any discussions with the public school system about their potentially funding?
Yes, sir. Okay. The outlook is not bright. Okay. No, sir. Not in the near term, at any rate. I think that they would love to participate, but because of the current state situation, and that occurs, that is in effect this year and will be again for the next budget year. That right now they're.
It seems like something that might come out of their bonding capacity, though, not out of their. It'd be a discussion for the school system, I suppose.
Yeah, it would, and I think I think they have, again, in the near term, a vote on bonding, a bond issue that is pretty much facilities-driven, not recreational division or sports-oriented.
You know, I'll tell you, I'm really shocked. I appreciate all you guys coming out tonight. I didn't expect this many people, so I think that's good. I just want to do, you know, that tournament, I didn't realize that was an option. I mean, I think that is something that would be, you know, something that Stillwater could talk about for years, and OSU could talk about for years. And so I think that should be a goal of ours from leaving this discussion, is how do we help to get there now? How do we find that money? I think that's something we need to look at right away, and I think we need to figure out if it's surfacing those courts, and then we need to find money for two more additional courts. Is that right? Two more or four more? Mm-hmm. Shaking some heads. Four more?
Mm-hmm. I think you need.
We needed 18.
But you're short six.
Four at Sunset, but now we have the four at Couch. That would.
And so we are starting
with
four.
So if we resurface Couch, that would get us those four, and then we just need two more. Which would be $200,000.
No, we would not need two more. We'd need 14 more?
No.
Eight
at the Colvin. Eight at the Colvin, four at Couch, and four at Sunset.
Have
so
we talked to
two more.
Have we talked to Stillwater Country Club?
I think they're in the Stillwater public schools situation.
Okay.
Okay.
I mean, I will go there if I have to. I think it'd be great if it all ties together.
I mean, that's just my comment leaving from this. I mean, I'd like to find a way to somehow also get to 18 if we can use the money already allocated, resurface, and then find money for two more. If you can get a neighborhood on board to agree to your Sunset Park, I think that's a good option, but I don't think that's gonna happen. And so I don't know where we.
I agree with you. We want the 18 almost as badly as you do, Chris. And I know that it's great that we're seeing everybody with the tennis balls. It's what we need in Stillwater, is this kind of participation and this kind of excitement. But it can't leave when you leave this room. we need your help. If we're going to do this, then we have to have your help. We don't have the money just to do this, or that we'll have to do it next year. But does that mean we can't do it? No. It just means we have to have this public-private partnership. We have to find out ways to find the money that we don't have and do this as a community. We can do that. And it was nice that, Chris, that you are here and that we have the Stillwater Tennis Association speaking up. I'm a little worried when you mentioned Stillwater Public Schools or Stillwater Medical Center without their... I don't think that you've really pitched this idea to them, and we have not pitched this idea to them. But I understand Stillwater Medical Center's generosity with the community, and they are a partner of the community. But I still need to point out they have not been talked to as of yet. And
staff also met with county and officials there. Don't think that that's appropriate for their, that that's not an appropriate expenditure of their funding.
So that's one other thing I want to say, is that staff really has been working on this for a long time, and then met with Henri and with Chris and with other people to come up with a plan. We're here, we're talking, that's the first step of the plan. And so tonight I would like to recommend, do you have anything else before I don't want to recommend anything until...
I've said my whole piece.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Partnership.
Partnership. So I would like to recommend that staff bring us back what they've heard tonight, which I think you've heard that before. Bring us back plans as to how we move forward with making this not just an option, but let's make it a vision and let's do it, but how do we get there? And I think it starts with public-private. That would be the first step.
Oh, absolutely, but particularly with the budgetary outlook for the next 2 or 3 years.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But,
okay. Can we also recommend that the overlay of Couch Park gets done? That's something the council?
Yes, and we need to do that and go ahead and spend the money that is budgeted toward resurfacing the 4 courts at Couch Park.
We should probably have a vote on that at our next. Next meeting.
The money's already in the budget.
It's okay.
The money's already in the budget. Staff can proceed with bids.
Can you? Okay.
And we can do that without a vote. It's in there. That's what you authorized 2 years ago for it to be spent on. So. The money's been carried forward, and we can do that.
Okay.
Okay, so.
I'd also like I want 2 more courts. discussion of finding. Don't clap because I'm not saying that's going to happen, but just.
How big is your backyard?
Yeah. I'm just saying, I think we are missing out on a big opportunity if we don't at least explore those options. I'm not saying we're going to find that, but I would at least like to look and see what the options are. For we have till 2019, right?
We're putting in the bids in June.
Well, if we said we're going to get them, right? I don't have to have them built by June. That's not going
to
happen. Okay.
We're going to have to have them done.
But if we okay.
Right.
So well, if we could explore the options.
That was what I was asking staff to do, was to explore everything that we're getting ready, that we want and need. Not just the resurfacing, but everything, how we get to it.
To be brought back.
Yes, after staff has had enough time.
I'm looking for Mr. McClinney.
He's right out there. He's hiding behind the door.
Any idea how much time you'd need, John?
Is a month enough time to bring back something to City Council?
Oh, yeah. In a public-private partnership, though, we are going to need a private partner. So that's one thing we've been talking to the Tennis Association about. They'll need to start working on forming a 501c3 and really getting things together on that end. So
we could look, you could talk about that, maybe have us a rough idea of what that would look like.
Yeah.
Maybe. Because I know they've talked about it.
If we're going to model it on McMurtry and Multi, that would be kind of how those began.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay. So we all have our marching orders then to start talking about the public-private partnership. We have staff working on a path forward that will work for everybody and that will bring in the tournaments that we would like to have here and we need to have here, and we need to provide the best facilities we can provide for all of these young people who are sitting out here tonight and all of everybody who's a tennis player. We want to do as the best job we can. We need your help.
One other comment. I would like to say that the plans for the Hamilton Field facility, those plans were lovely. And I'm really sad that they won't come to fruition right now. I appreciate all the work that was done on those. And I think it was quite a gift.
Mm-hmm.
Quite a gift.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you guys so much for coming.
Take a break in between. I'm just asking.
I think we'll take a 5-minute break before we do the next round. Away, all the people with wearing the tennis ball can escape.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, he's not done.
Probably should have asked that.
Yeah.
Here on Stillwater 360, we'll provide you news you need to know 3 days a week in 60 seconds about the city of Stillwater. It's time to start thinking about enrolling in swim and tennis lessons with the city. Enrollment is now open for youth beginners and advanced beginners tennis lessons and youth parent and taught and adult swim lessons. You can find a full schedule of the sessions offered over the summer and the registration forms on our website at stillwater.org under the Parks and Recreation page. There's also info about signing up for private lessons and municipal pool hours of operation, season passes, and punch cards on our website. The pool opens Saturday, May 28th. If you have questions, you can also call City of Stillwater Parks and Recreation at 405-747-8070. There's your news in 60 seconds. Have a great day, Stillwater.
Well, as long as we don't get severe weather, it's actually really good.
We're all back.
Yeah. I hadn't had it before.
All right, are we ready for part two? Or item B? Okay, I'm going to call us back in session, okay. Works, okay. So we have the discussion of the downtown redevelopment project, and I'm going to turn over for the start of the project to Mr. McNichol.
Well, since discussion ended, previous discussion ended, we've kind of kicked this idea around, and we have questions. And I can run down the list of those questions right quick. And then we have a short presentation for you, but some of the questions that I have about the use of Block 34 and tonight's discussion, I believe, is specifically about Block 34, would be, should the space be 100% public space? If not 100% public use, then what use would the council be looking at? Should we consider arranging the area for downtown events such as the festival or the arts festival, farmers market, food trucks and tunes, and other events? And if we did that and then planned appropriately, it could eliminate blocking downtown streets and eliminate businesses and office complaints about parking where the streets are blocked. Duncan could be temporarily closed between 8th and 9th. And the street parking lot at the community center could be incorporated into those activities. Or you could really think further, and you could close Duncan Street altogether and incorporate it into use in the whole project. If the use is to be 100% public, what features? What would you like to see involved there? Certainly, I think one of the things that we should look at would be public restrooms, regardless of what we do with the entirety of the problem or the property. Should there be a pavilion? Should there be an amphitheater which doubles as a drainage feature? If so, on block 34 or partially on 35, or use part of Duncan Street for the location, tying an amphitheater to the community center, so that the backstage of the community center could be used also for the amphitheater. There are a lot of other questions. And then we had kind of talked about this around City Hall, and a couple of staff members took this on, and they've come up with a concept that I would like you to take a look at. And because we are not into retail, it is 100% public use. We're not proposing that. We're not trying to move the council in any specific direction. It's just that our expertise is in something other than retail or in the hotel industry. And we just, a couple of very talented people came up with some ideas that could be incorporated, could not be incorporated, but just to show what might fit on that lot and how it might be arranged. So I'd like to call on Paula Dennison.
And before we even do that, I just want to, I know when we first started this discussion, we never really talked about full public use, or we never even heard of that as an option. But I know I asked you today, but I'd like you to just say it to the public. Why did someone come up with this concept that we're going to see tonight?
It is merely a concept. It is to show what public features could be added. If part of it is public, if it's all private, then that's a different story. But again, we're not
well,
experts.
And I guess we just heard so much during all of this study and all of the research that we've done. We've certainly started to hear people say public, and so we wanted to be able to look at that at least and see what that meant. So this just gives us another option. We're not saying anything other than here's another option. So with that said, I would like to, would you please bring up the staff so they can show us?
Yes, Paula Dennison is going to run us through this, and I would like to give credit where credit is due. Patty Evans, Tom Coots, the one that came up with this concept. So,
good evening, Paula Dennison, Development Services. Like City Manager McNichol indicated, we have the staff that just had also heard a lot of the comments from the public input sessions and opportunities for the public to speak and voice their concerns. And staff has some really cool software gadgets upstairs, and they were excited to have an opportunity just to see conceptually what the block could be used for. Of course, purpose, central location for gatherings and festivals, revitalization and redevelopment. There are a number of increasing number of events that the city is hosting, and having a downtown park is actually recommended by several plans that we have. This is just a picture of the possible entryway, and I'll bring up a map that shows the overall concept. But this, from sort of eye level, gives you an idea of standing out at one of the corners of the street intersections, what you would be looking at. The name Founders Park ties to the history of the downtown, recognizes early founders of the city. We think history is very important, but also providing future for some of the modern amenities that you will see here. So now, an overview. And this does take up the entire block. What you will see, this is 8th Avenue at the top, 9th, Husband, and Duncan. So a couple of the things that you will see here. Seating area, a spring and stream, and you can follow the stream down to another larger area water feature. We have a plaza, and that was the entryway that you saw on the previous slide. a playground. I'll get to a little more specifics and details. A lot of history is built in throughout this entire concept. Public art scattered about, an amphitheater, the tree alley, two of them actually, outdoor gym, and an adult playground. So put the street names on here. And the main entry, again, is coming in. This is at the southwest corner of 8th and Husband, which would be at this location. You can see this proposed to be just a water wall. And there is a picture of a water wall and what it could conceivably look like. There's also some historical information here in the vicinity and the reference to Norman from the coach earlier wearing his OSU shirt. I was just in the back just dying on that one. But the city of Norman does have a very interesting map in one of their city parks, and this is an actual picture of it, and it does display some of the history of that area of Oklahoma. And that was one of the ideas, one of the thoughts that staff had for the entryway. We have a variety of historic kiosks, as you can see. Couch, Husband, Lowry, a number of the kiosks for founding fathers, and even some of the OSU presidents we have identified in this area as well. And there would be not only public art, as you can see in the background, but there would also be some history about Stillwater associated at these kiosks. And this is what I think is just the coolest thing that they came up with. Old Town, Old Stillwater, Children's Playground, clapboard sidewalk, the building facades of the old Western towns, train, horses, wagon. And then you have the more modern playground equipment also around. The spring and the streams that had the two larger water bodies and then the spring running through would be able to be navigated across. And just a couple of ideas, play areas for the children or adults if you are so inclined. A seating plaza, opportunities that I'll show you here in a minute for outdoor eating. And this seating plaza is, as you can tell, in close proximity to the children's playground. So any keepers of the children, they'd be able to have keep an eye on them while they were enjoying a cup of coffee or anything from the food trucks. So we have 8th and Duncan. As you can see, one of the streets we have actually designated as the food truck way with some removable eating, sitting and eating right there in the right-of-way. And that would also lend to the activities going on. Then we get to the amphitheater. This amphitheater, the stage area would be at a lower elevation than the streets around. That would help block not only noise, but some of the wind that would be coming through. It would be faced, and we'll see it again on the large view, it would be facing south. The stage would face south. Turning it east and west, you're having conflicts with the rising and or setting sun. So that would be make it a little more difficult. So the south facing is how staff proposed it. And then the adult type playgrounds. There are many opportunities out there. We see them. You can watch television and see them. Any movie shot around Central Park in New York will have the outdoor adult swings, chess boards, ping pong tables, where people just congregate and they just gather. And so here's a couple of examples of that, as well as some of the adult play exercise equipment that could help Stillwater towards being a more healthy community, having this installed. So that's the overall concept. Here again, it's just a concept of all of the activities that could occur, all of the ages, ranges, abilities that could be met out there and interests that could be met out there just on that block. So again, great Great job by staff just throwing this together. Pretty quickly, they threw it together. And Patty and Tom, like I said, they were very excited to be able to do this and then run it by the manager's office late last week. So be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, so any of these ideas, which they were all wonderful, if we couldn't keep everything, how do we decide what we want to keep and what do we want to do? I think Vice Mayor may have a solution. She was grinning. So,
any questions for Paula?
Did you mention farmers market?
No, but there is, if you can see from the overview, there's quite a bit of open space that's left that could accommodate not a not something like the amphitheater or the playground or the seating that is out there all the time, but events that could come and go could provide that space, as could any of the streets. They could accommodate at any given time also.
Are those street widths? Those look really wide. On Husband and Duncan, are those, is it Duncan?
The majority in the original town of Stillwater are platted at 100 feet wide. The majority of the streets are in
the ones out
downtown
there now
Stillwater.
Aren't, right?
The rights of way, oh. The rights of way are pretty close to 100 feet. They're all 100.
So you could do that given the existing
yes.
infrastructure down there? Cool. How much does something like this cost?
This is, believe me, this is just a concept. What could be out there? We did not put pennies to it at all.
A lot. Yeah. It would cost a lot.
We like public-private partnerships.
It would be multiple million dollars.
How many acres is a block?
Two.
I think I'm going to be the naysayer on the council and tell you, when I opened this email Friday, I was shocked because we pretty much took any help we were going to get from anyone, and the city would have to pay for every single dime of this development. And I've been thinking about this all weekend, and I just, you know, it's amazing that we spent $140,000 or however much on ADG to develop a plan for us, and now we've come and developed another plan. I know it's just a concept, but if we had the ability to do this concept in-house, I have no idea why we did an urban planner. And so to me, I'm very shocked by this. I know it's a concept, but I don't know what else to say. I think there's great ideas in it, don't get me wrong, and I think it looks great, and I appreciate them doing it, but I don't know. To me, I guess I'm just, like I said, I'm the naysayer in it, but it's surprising to me, so.
What we spent on ADG, we needed to spend. We needed to get the conversation started, so I just want to remind you that it wasn't, we didn't hire them. We hired them for a specific thing and put out a specific RFP. But we also, after speaking with a lot of individuals, heard what we thought would maybe need to consider a third option, which was to keep the public space public.
So why didn't we have them develop the third option? We paid them.
We would have to pay them more.
But it just doesn't make sense to me. I mean, we paid someone to start a conversation that we were already having. And now we have, I'm just saying, if we had the people in-house to do this.
We didn't know that we had the people in-house.
Yes, we did. Tom Coots gave us a plan when we first started this conversation last year. Tom developed a video and showed it to the entire council. And so we had that plan. We knew he could do this.
And we had people who thought that we needed to go in a different direction, which is why we hired someone. We didn't do it willy-nilly.
Councilor Nahara, I agree with your frustration. I'm frustrated also. in my private life, I'm not a very patient person. So this entire process has been a little bit stressful. And, you know, did we do everything right? No. Did we do everything wrong? No. We've learned something different at each stage. If we could roll the clock back and do it over again, perhaps we would do it differently. We've already done it. So where do we go from right now instead of, you know, everything that we did wrong?
I don't disagree with that one bit. I'm voicing my concerns just as every single other person on this council has. And so it's hard for me.
Do you not want us to move forward with this third plan?
Mayor Noble, that's exactly not what I'm saying. I am just merely voicing my concerns. I would love to hear the concerns of the citizens that have requested to speak today about what they feel. And who knows, maybe I'll be swayed. It's hard for me. I can't get over the idea. And I understand your point saying it was to help us move along the conversation. And I don't disagree with some of that, but I just...
Did you vote for that?
I can't remember.
I believe you did.
I don't think I did, but...
I believe you did.
Can we look that up? Because I don't think I did vote for that, but...
It doesn't matter.
I regret my vote if I did vote for ADG. I will say that publicly because I don't feel like we got our money's worth if we had the people in-house. So, but I don't know if I voted for it. So I regret
it. Well, it doesn't matter. I shouldn't have
said that. But you asked. So I just want that to be on the record.
We need to move forward.
Yes,
and that's what we're doing, and that's what we've been doing. And ADG started the conversation. We had many conversations where we talked with people, and they brought their ideas to us. And one of the ideas that we heard over and over again was keep the public space public. We had never heard that before, which is why we did it in-house, didn't hire or didn't spend more money. Just to talk about what do we need to do with the public space?
Evidently build an amphitheater and some parks.
Well, I think
I was here for most of these discussions, but I wasn't on the council, so I'm gonna speak from this point forward instead of this point back. I don't understand the tack that you're taking right now with this, but the question I think we were asked tonight was, is the idea of having a 100% public or mostly public use of this block a good one and one that we want to pursue? I have two answers to that question. One, absolutely I want it to be. This concept, this idea of having this big open green space downtown and a downtown park, I think is fantastic. Your comment earlier about taking away all the other sources of funding to actually do this is also, I think, very well taken, right? Because this is, I mean, my question, how much does this cost? I mean, this is city funded. Nobody else is going to pay for this. I would love to see some possibility of a combination of this plan with somebody else paying for parts of it. If we can incorporate some commercial aspect into this kind of a plan where, you know, one of these corners is instead a restaurant of some kind and there's some private development that's done as a part of the plan so that we do have some other people footing some of this bill. Because I think that's a great point. You're right. I mean, the whole point of looking at this as a private development was that somebody else is going to pay for it. We don't have to do it. But I would really like to have this big park downtown. So
I'm not against the park. I just told the Tennis Association, I wanted to help them. I'm not against the park. I'm just saying I'm surprised by this plan is all I wanted to express. But apparently I was not allowed to do that. But I am just surprised. Thank you for your work on this. I do appreciate it very much. I apologize if my comments were taken poorly. I do appreciate your work. I'm just very surprised. That's all.
I'm not surprised that we have a few speakers. Was that a nice segue? We have a few speakers tonight. The first speaker is Alan Brunken.
I'm Alan Brunken, an emeritus member of the School of Architecture faculty. I came to Stillwater in 1975. I've lived here for 41 years. Or more. One thing that I've seen about the city of Stillwater is that it doesn't seem to have a sense of place about it. We have the activities on Main Street. We have the activities on Duck Street. We have the post office. We have all these bits and pieces, but there's no soul in Stillwater. And from an architectural planning point of view, one of the most important things in a city is the open spaces, not just the buildings. The open spaces are places where we share our lives, and they have meaning. And what's really special about the opportunity we have here in Stillwater, very rare, that there is an open block at precisely the place that it needs to be. At a place that could knit Duck Street with Main Street. And it would be a place, I kind of think of this opportunity as one where we can build a living room for Stillwater. We don't have that. Main Street is nice. It seems to be healthy now. Duck Street for sure is healthy, but they're separate. It's sort of like, I think of a good chef has all the ingredients on top of the counter. That's us in Stillwater. But in order for the cake to be made, we have to mix them together. We have all the ingredients on the counter. We're not mixing them together. And I think this open space, I strongly think that this should be a park. It should have a clear image. I wouldn't want to mix in any restaurant. This ought to be, think of how wonderful some of the towns in Oklahoma are that have a city square. It actually gives the city identity. And so I think if we have a clear vision of what we want to do, well, what I hope we don't do, if I can say it maybe in the opposite way, is we have this open space. And if we give this to a developer, is the time up?
Just finish your thought.
If we give the open space to a developer, that person is going to look at it in terms of dollars, profit. I don't know that that's what we ought to be about. We ought to have a vision about our city. Maybe we do it in phases. One of the things I was in practice before I joined the faculty. I worked with IBM, GE, all of it. Even the wealthy corporate clients cannot afford to do everything in one fell swoop. What do? You do it in phases. And so if we can come up with a concept that allows us to do things in phases, Pac-Man style, I think the tennis people might want to think about that. Who can do it all in one fell swoop? So it's important that you have an architectural concept that allows you to do that. One other thing that I might say, this is a sort of a tangential thing, we don't need a parking garage right now. If you read the parking study, I don't know if you're into this, we have over 560 excess parking spaces right now. So let's put that to rest. Parking garages are very expensive, and they are dead areas in the city. They offer nothing to the life of the city. So that's why I bring this up. Be very careful when you think about a parking garage.
Thank you for your time. And we have Mr. Russ Tubner.
Mayor Noble, thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. First of all, I'd like to say how excited I am, looking forward to air service coming to Stillwater. I lost my voice on a flight last night coming in about 1 a.m., so I will be thrilled when we get to that point. As I pull up my slides, My prepared remarks with these slides will probably last 6 minutes. Do I have your permission to go that long?
It's fine.
Okay, thank you very much. I titled this presentation, let's see how we do this, full screen mode, What, Yes, Where, No. We talked a lot about the ADG project, and I think it was, personally, I don't begrudge the city spending the money one bit, because I think it forced us to walk down certain paths. Particularly, it helped us answer some very important questions, particularly, what do we want downtown? First of all, and according to the ADG document, and this is certainly fair based upon the community input I heard or listened to, we want to retain and renovate the community center and the Houston Auditorium. There was a lot of energy around the idea of a hotel and a conference center, meeting space where we can attract economic development and outside events, new people, new dollars into this zone. Thirdly, outdoor amenities, including public space. Mixed-use areas, we want more retail, more office, more residential. We want those things. And we also do, I think, need parking assets along the way. So to me, I think the what of the question was answered pretty well. I don't begrudge it at all. The where question, I believe, was hampered by a constraint. And that is that the ADG was told to focus their efforts on two square blocks, Block 34 and Block 35. What we learned in this process is that there is not a lot of community support for significant redevelopment on Block 35, where the community center is right now. And as a result, what happened on Block 34 was a little bit of everything over there. Now, since a little bit of everything ended up on Block 34, I think we have to fairly ask the question, is it enough of anything to make a long-term or significant impact? Personally, to me, I think it does have some drawbacks. I think former Councilor Weaver stated it perfectly at a meeting a few weeks ago. And that is, if we develop Block 34, we, as proposed, we lose, perhaps forever, an opportunity to have a large public outdoor space. Number two, developing Block 34 in a heavy manner really creates kind of a development pod, an enclave, a little cluster right there that's really, to me, doesn't look well integrated into the rest of downtown. And then third, the proposed plan creates really a physical and almost a psychological barrier right in the exact spot that should be the hub of downtown. It creates a barrier, physical barrier, between, for example, the OSU Art Museum and the Duncan Street corridor, which we've talked about. Now, I'm going to be referencing Block 40 and 41 as well, because I think they're integral to giving us the freedom to reconceive of Block 34. So just as a map, Block 40 is the block in which the north half is privately owned and the south half is owned, at least provisionally, by the Wondertorium. And then the city is the fallback owner if, in fact, the Wondertorium does not build there. And then Block 41 is privately owned property. Approximately 2 years ago, one of the projects that I undertook was to clean up the ownership structure of those blocks. To me, just strategically, the ability to think creatively and strategically about Block 41 and 40 had to do with the ownership structure and the existing structures there. So my objective, my passion for a year or so, was to try to change that. And so I created an entity called Sona Stillwater. And you can see in red the areas that Sona now owns, and we, in fact, rent, and we are modestly improving and renting those facilities there. That, I think, makes Sona the second largest owner of that area right behind the city. And we're proud to work with you in that regard. I think we accomplished our objective, because now if you look at the layout of ownership in the area, Block 35 and 34, of course, have one owner, that being the city. Block 40 has three owners. You're one of them. Block 41 has only four owners now. And if you look at total unique owners, there are only eight. Now, that's a very manageable number. I mean, we can have a meeting at Red Rock, right? We can all fit. This is not that difficult. Now, But the question then becomes, what do we want? What are the proposed objectives? Now, I'm going to reiterate some of the themes that have already been offered. And the first one is to maximize open space, spread the development out over a larger area to fit with the feel of downtown. Two, allocate enough space to each social or economic asset to really make a difference. Third, create a physical and a psychological hub around which all of downtown revolves and development goes out from it, not right on it. Number four, create a sense of passage through the space between the OSU Art Museum and the Duncan Street Corridor. And then five, limit private development on public land to assets which have a compelling community benefit. Now, to me, compelling community benefits, what qualifies? I do think supporting a hotel and conference center, at least in concept, if not in money, is a compelling benefit. And then I definitely think that food and beverage pad sites around a common green space are definitely a community benefit. So with that in mind, I commissioned a small drawing, and before I show it to you, I will just say that this is by no means cast in stone. This is just me wanting to put a finger in the water to say this is what another way to look at downtown. Now, the key aspect of this, or a key, is the idea of the Oklahoma Wondertorium taking up residence in the existing community center. That, if they were willing to do that, if they could do that, that would free up their ownership interest in the south part of Block 41. That then allows us to have an entire block. And again, there are only three legal owners of Block 41. I am one of them, you are another, and there is another who I am in significant contact with. So the idea of using that block to attract a hotel and a conference center there gives us ample room, physical room and space, to be able to build a facility that could be really practical and useful to certain parties in town. For example, Career Tech, the State Department of Vocational and Technical Education, can't host one of their 300-person conferences in Stillwater. And their stated reason is lack of facilities. The other thing that you'll see is Block 41, which is this area over here, dealing with the multi-use and residential area. Now, this could be conceived of all sorts of different ways, but I would also point out up here in the Block 34 area, I think there is a compelling reason to create commercial pad sites at the corners. I think the idea of someone on campus knowing that they can come down, sit on a terrace, have a meal, enjoy a beer, look out on a public green is very compelling. So I think creating some economic development activity, even on Block 34 using pad sites, is very practical, very doable. There are a number of assumptions here.
Mr. Tubner, you need to.
Okay. There are a number of assumptions here. One is that on Block 41, the Wondertorium would be willing to and able to swap their land for the right to use the community center. On this block, the primary assumption is that Block 41 owners can come to a consensus about the complete redevelopment of that block, and I'm already in contact with all of them. No one has said no. Here are my requests to close. First of all, forgive the roughness of the drawings. I have some others that should be prepared if this idea meets with your favor. Two, please do not issue an RFP for Block 34 as currently proposed. We all need time to consider alternatives. Number three, please allow time for the Wondertorium to study the idea of taking space in the community center. And number four, please allow time for those of us who are owners of Block 41 to determine if we can come together and create a viable mixed-use, privately funded commercial development on that block. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tubner. Do councilors have questions or comments about anything that we have heard tonight?
I feel like there are as many ideas about these two blocks as there are people in this city, which is good. I think that's a good thing, and we're hearing a lot of them. It's a difficult place for the council in terms of figuring out which direction to go. As I said before, the question tonight about how much of this block should be dedicated to public use space. I personally feel like we should try to keep as much of it open as we can. As Councilor Weaver said before, I agree with that position. We're not going to get another chance to have an open green in this town. So I would hope that we'd move forward in a way that explores options for that sort of use on Block 34.
Mr. Prunkin has a comment.
Yes.
Something about the planning process. You bring up a very good point. Where do we go from here, or how do we go from here? Rather than look at Block 34, Block 40, and Block 41, what is good planning practice, if you're doing a project, is you must have a master plan for one magnitude bigger than your project. You need to fit in. Don't just solve something on one block or two blocks. And I think we have that plan, the Puma plan. And what I would urge you to do is to look at what was stated in that plan. And then when it comes, if we do have a park, I think one of the initial things, and I think you're seeing this, is that we need to get input from the various users. There's a very simple statement. Before you solve a problem, you need to know what the problem is. And so we're probably in the problem-seeking stage right now, trying to understand what it is. But the planning process, don't look at just the particular blocks. You have to look at a larger fabric and how it ties in. I don't know how you want to do that, but that's what needs to be done.
Thank you.
Hello. Yeah, you know, I'm looking at this paper we were given just earlier. And in 2013, the city of Stillwater did a proposition to raise money to build, upgrade new parks, build an amphitheater. And I was one of the 1,146 people that voted yes on that. And there was 4,804 other people that voted no on it. So to me, this looks great. And I really do like the idea of putting more green space. I agreed with Councilor Weaver when he said that. I think that's a great idea. And I do think we should explore it more, but I think we have to scale this back quite a bit. I think there has to be a good balance of development and open space. And so I think, you know, my opinion moving forward is we have to figure out a way to finance this, because it doesn't seem like, unless the mood in the city has changed in 3 years, that we're going to get anyone on board to, other than the 1,145 other people, to help us get this done on the city's dime. So I think it's a great idea, and I like some concepts of it. I've always been in favor of the farmer's market down there. I've always been in favor of the area for the food trucks. I like the idea of putting some sort of playground, but I just think we still have to have a way to pay for a good majority of it. And I think the last gentleman, you know, I mean, he makes a good point that we really have to figure out the whole plan. And, you know, I think we do have a lot in play. Obviously, there's several other, you know, blocks in play. But I think our job is to figure out the two we own and what's best for it. And, you know, I'm not against a little more green, but I just think we have to be reasonable with knowing what we can afford and what we can't afford.
Well, I agree that we do have to know what we're going to pay for, but I think we need to have a picture of what we want first so we can do the phasing. Exactly as Mr. Brunkin said, we can't do everything at once, and you build a plan that you can do along the way. I think that, so having the concept is huge. And as I said, we learned something all along the way. The people that presented from Branson, I mean, they kind of opened my eyes in a sense to don't just look at this part. You need to think about the streets that are coming into this. Think about this as part of the city, not just a couple of blocks. We've got some very talented people. We've had some other beautiful presentations from local people. And we're building. I'm uncomfortable when you bring up the last bond issue as a sign that people are not willing to pay for things. There were many pieces of that last bond issue that had nothing to do with whether you wanted to have an amphitheater or
but
something
I didn't
else.
Talk about those other two.
Well, I was one of the 4,000 people that voted no.
Hey. Because oh, you voted no?
No, because of the structure of that presentation. And I'm hoping that we are doing this differently.
So are you in favor of putting a bond out there to pay for this?
I've talked about bonds for a long time, but I don't know enough about bonds to say, let's do that right now.
How would you, just off the top of your head, how would you...
I don't know. I would say that's it has to be done in pieces. Yeah, I'm not.
I want the city staff to come.
I mean, if she has an idea, I'm just trying to get ideas. Just
well, I think we have to have a picture of what we want
before we can place.
And then we find out it's $19 million, and we say we can afford $500,000. What can we do for $500,000 toward this project? And next year, how much can we afford? And then in 3 years, how much can we afford?
And with that, I would like to propose that the city take all of the input that we just had tonight and tell us what's the best way to move forward based on what you have heard. We're going to have to make a decision about Block 34, even though it is part of a bigger picture, which it certainly is. It's all about the bigger picture. How do we get to the bigger picture? I believe a lot of private developers are the people who do that. But we do have these two public spaces that we have to make a decision on that impact more than just those two blocks. And I think that's where we need the best information we can get. And so I would like staff to bring something back to us that tells us you could do this, this, and this. This is how much the concept costs. This would be approximately how much you would have to finance it this way. Give us the good and the bad about all of the different options so we can make the best choice.
But I'm a little confused of what choice are they giving? I mean, with what design, I guess is what I'm wondering. You're asking them to, like you just said, finance and...
If we did public space, okay. and we used something. So we have ideas on how much it costs on the other two uses. But we don't have for this. And we're not going to even know until we... I think we're going to have a committee where we all nominate people. People go onto the committee, and we get ideas for what we want, what we don't want on the exact public land, and move for if that's how we're doing it. But we've got to make a decision first. This is just a concept. It's just an idea. What do we like about Block 34? How do we want to use it? So I'm with Mr. Joyce. I would like to see as much used for public as we can possibly afford. I know that it's going to cost a lot to do this, so we have to have a reality check.
So just so I can understand, so we're going to give staff the direction to figure out concepts and financing, and then we're going to create a committee to work on those?
No.
I just need to understand so that when someone asks me what we decided or we talked about, I can tell them. I'm just trying to understand.
Okay. Maybe I could say it in a different way. We want staff to come back with us and just, we already have the other numbers for how much it will cost to do a hotel and a conference center. But we had never heard of a public use, so we didn't, we have no understanding of how much it would cost us to build something like that. If it's going to be, you know, more than the other two, we have to really think about that. And I think that staff is just going to have to do some investigation and look into, is this something we even want to do? Or do we want to just vote on what ADG proposed for those two spaces? Is that confusing still?
Well, I mean, I'm not dumb. I just, you know, okay.
Well, I think
I don't think we're going to see eye to eye on this. So I'm.
Well, what do you want? Like, what do you want us to do?
No, I just kind of feel like we've gone back a little bit. I mean, when we started this back in last year, all of us were on the council, and so I won't say much to you. But I just felt like we kind of had some. We put out an RFP. We had three plans. We decided none of those were good, and so we tried to work with a group, and that didn't work. And so then we hired Pegasus and ADG, who are urban planners, to help us design this, and they had community focus groups and tried to help us to figure out what a good plan going forward is. And now we're still kind of stepping back, and we're going to find out what other plans are going forward, and we might have a committee of citizens to meet together to talk about it.
I don't know that we ever made the decision, Miguel, was if this was going to be public or private.
Well, that's
and
one we thing did have, to talk
and
about,
we had but. Three good plans. Not that we didn't have a good plan. We had three very nice plans presented to us, at least three, and they never did you ever feel like the whole group went, wow, this is what exactly what we want. That was what I was dreaming about. And then when we got public comments, which was a huge thing that kind of put the skids on, we did have to step back. We do have to step back and listen to what, you know, when people began paying attention to what they want. And I think that, you know, it does feel like, really, like backwards. And I really want to do it right. I was looking at other cities and their downtown redevelopment plans, and you know, this is not just unique to Stillwater. I mean, there are cities that have been working on their downtown redevelopment for 15 years in phases, and it takes a while.
Yeah, no, I understand that. I'm just trying to say I feel like we've kind of almost, and we all, I think, have kind of agreed that we started this a little weird, how we started it, and so, but it just kind of seems like we always get stuck. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I would think in a year and a half we'd have something, but.
And we do.
Well, you do.
We have a lot.
You do. You have a very clear understanding that people do not want you to build big commercial developments on Lot 34 and Lot 35. I mean, that is the outcome of the planning that's been done over the last year.
I don't know because I don't think everyone said that.
I listened to every single one of those people at every one of those meetings. The people who showed up at the meetings and told us what they wanted, they didn't want that. That was very clear, I thought, from the meetings. Is that not what other people thought from those meetings?
No, I absolutely thought
I don't. I mean, that wasn't. It was pretty clear that this was not those. The development plans that we've seen for those two blocks did not have wide support. I don't say they're not bad plans, but they didn't have wide support. And what we've seen wider support of is more public use for this space downtown. I'm just saying what I've seen.
Okay. So why don't we move forward with a concept to look at an RFP for more public use and some retail? I mean, that's...
I don't
hate to rush into an RFP before we've had a chance to say as a group we want this to be like this. I think we can each be speaking
with staff between now and if we got it back in A month? Is that what? We could have questions answered. The public can send us in questions. I want to reiterate, I don't think we're going backward at all. I think we are moving forward in a smart, planned way that may feel like a step back and a step forward, but I want to do this correctly, too. We didn't do the PUMA plan. We have this other plan that has been presented to us, and then we find out more information, and it's the information I'm talking about on the Lot 34. I think we owe it to the citizens to listen a little bit and to study to make something else happen as well, or something to vote on.
Having listened here tonight, perhaps what staff could do is take a look at the lot as it exists, and that is not permanent hard surface parking. We could tell you what it would take to pull up the, I believe they're screenings that we put, some people call them screenings, they're asphalt renderings and that kind of thing. Pull that up, put grass in it. What it would take to install some electric outlets to be able to have events there. What it would take, and kind of give you a progressive list to a certain point that would be beyond our operations division ability to provide.
Are you saying that operations could put down some grass?
They could put down some grass, and we've got great talented folks that could put in some electrical outlets and some water outlets to make it usable for public events while the conversation continues on whether at the corner of the 8th and Husband you need retail space. That conversation could continue. And we could give you a progressive list of what we could do and for how much money. I think there's some things we could do that, even though we're not in the best of shape financially right now, that we could do with our own resources to at least show some progress to the lot.
I think whether we did totally commercial or totally public, the sidewalks and the streets need a major overhaul. And that was going to be a huge cost of either way we go. I think, if you look at Monroe, after they resurfaced that and put the new curbs on, it changed the whole flavor of that street. Those are those kinds of things to understand what they are going to be. Also,
and it would probably be a couple of years before we could program in streets, but I'm saying we could do some preliminary small things now, just you could go down there on a Friday afternoon, look around and say, what had fit here? I don't know. But we could give you a progressive list of grass, a pavilion that could be moved to another location, the water
give us the bare minimum and give us some of the, that would be really cool, and give us what we saw.
I can already do that. That's $5 or $6 million.
I would hate for us to do something temporary that ends up to be permanent. I mean, I'm all for doing something, but let's not do something just to appease us.
No,
patient people.
I'm talking about you could actually make it usable, and these would be portable things. I mean, with the exception of.
Well, that's a great suggestion from the book Startup City that Charlotte Lovern has recommended. You know, just get something up; it doesn't have to be permanent.
It can be built onto, and it can be in a plan for many years on how we will update. We just want to move forward in a smart, planned way. That's how we must do this, and we must keep the momentum going. And every once in a while, we're going to come across a glitch where I wish we would have done something differently, but our promise to the public is we are moving forward. So we will wait to hear from staff. The second meeting is 17th?
16th. 16th or 17th. Mm-hmm.
If that is a date you can accomplish, that would be great. If not, as soon as we can.
Okay.
Anybody else? Any other comments? All right. With that, I will. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to adjourn the April 25th City Council meeting. Please vote. And we are adjourned with a vote of 4-0.